going to start by saying, Kelsey, congratulations on this beautiful, amazing book of poetry that you have written. I feel like your heart and soul is in these pages.
It's true.
Why did you write this beautiful book of poetry?
You know, I put out my record, the last record I did, Kelsey, March 20th. It was like the week the world shut down. And I have big feelings, you know this about me as a friend, but my way of grieving kind of this project that I loved so much was that I had to detach the writing from the music. Music, it's always been a place of safety and celebration and happiness, and it wasn't that for me anymore because it represented something that, you know, was disappointing and sad.
Or could fall apart.
And so I detached the writing from the music, and I kept writing because that's how I process life. I had 10,000 words a few months later, and I was like, I think this is a book.
Wow.
Yeah.
If you have 10,000 words to share about something, it was supposed to happen.
It was supposed to happen. Yeah. It was, yes.
Okay, so in March 2020, you had an album that was coming out. You couldn't tour. You couldn't promote it. Like
the brakes.
Like you were running on a treadmill and somebody just pushed stop.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was really scary. And I think I just had the choice of like, how am I going to handle this? Am I going to handle this in a healthy way or an unhealthy way? And it was the first opportunity I really had to lift up my head and go, I'm not 19 anymore. When did this happen? I'm 26 at the time or whatever. Who am I now? Mm-hmm. How do I feel about my life now? What has the growth been? What are the things that I haven't processed yet? And there was a lot. And this is the way I really have always processed my life, but this was the way of processing things even from my childhood that I've just shoved down and I'm like, ding, let's go sing, you know? So it's been healthy.
You're so much of a storyteller through your music. And I think what really resonates with me with a lot of your storytelling is how honest you are about your upbringing and where you're from. I do want to say one of the first things that struck me when I read one of your poems was about that you're an old soul, because that is how I feel about you. I always frequently leave hanging out with you and I think, this woman is an old soul. So what was that like growing up, sort of feeling these big feelings and maybe not relating to your peers?
I think that I just kind of became someone who stepped outside of the cliques and the norms of young kids and just kind of became an observer.
So that's what it was like for you in high school and junior high. You were sort of on the outside.
I was so interested in the dynamics of people. Mm-hmm. I've always been interested in that. Like what makes people kind of click together, fall apart. That's what makes me such a peacemaker. I write about that. That's such an underlying tone.
Yeah.
In the whole book, I'm like, I'm an only child. I'm a Virgo. You know, I'm like, I'm a 9 on the Enneagram. I'm everything where I'm like, are you good? Because I'll like move heaven and earth to make sure you're good, you know?
Right.
And I think that dynamic happening to me really young has always kind of made me just look at the outside and just go, okay, they seem good. How are they? What can I do to help them? Yeah, it's interesting, but that became a huge underlying piece of this book that I actually didn't really notice until I read it back. And I was like, wow, I didn't realize how much of who I am is making sure everything's okay.
What is that process for? Like, do you have a therapist? Do you talk to anybody?
I do, yeah. I have been in therapy in and out my whole life. It's interesting though, because when I was younger, it was stuff that I was always kind of made to do. Like it was all kind of forced upon me. So I always had this stigma around it where I was like, this feels taboo. This feels like something other people want me to do. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until the last few years that it was my decision where I was like, I can be a healthier person. I have anxiety. A lot of people do. We live in a very difficult time, you know?
Right.
Like, so yeah, it's something I talk about a lot. It's just like mental health and being able to feel safe.
Well, I love that you are so outspoken about that too, because mental health is such a big thing on everybody's mind and we talk about it a lot, but do we really take care of ourselves? Are we endlessly scrolling through body image stuff that makes us feel less than?
Yeah.
You definitely address like you had early body image stuff eating disorder, and I thought that was so emotionally true and thoughtful and raw the way you write about it.
Thank you. I remember, you know, when I was, especially a preteen, how impressionable I was by pop culture. You know, it was Taylor Swift and Miley Cyrus and these people that I loved their music, but I loved them, you know? Like, if they wore a certain pair of jeans, I would want to go get those jeans. You know, it was so much more than just the music, and so I recognize now that if there are people that look up to me, I used to think that being a role model meant being squeaky clean and being seemingly perfect and having it all together, and I've had to recalibrate what that means, and now my definition of it is, am I being honest? Like, am I pulling back the curtain, and am I being vulnerable? Am I giving a young girl not an image to look up to, going, okay, I have to do that, I have to look like that, I have to approach life like that? Am I giving her the truth? Am I saying, you know, this is a hard world. When we are scrolling, we're not looking at pictures of people that are real. Like, this is filtered, this is not, you shouldn't compare yourself to this. This is difficult, you know? I've just decided that it's a little bit more important to me to say that out loud and take the stigma away from that and go like, okay, I'm an open book. This has been hard for me. I'm gonna be honest about that, and I'm gonna open the conversation. So if you need a friend to talk to this about, I'm here. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm gonna take the sting away for you. I'm here.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think it's great to see that someone even like you, who presents so beautifully and composed, has really struggled with a lot of body dysmorphia.
Yes.
I think we all have dealt with it.
Yes.
Particularly, I feel like it preys on young women.
Yeah.
And now we have empirical data that it preys on women.
It's
just, we know now.
Yes.
Social media is not healthy for us.
No.
You know, we have to really encourage ourselves to put the phone down and also have a wide variety and a spectrum of bodies that we see. Representation, that's really important. I wanted to say this one line I thought was so beautiful that you wrote in this poem about what's expected of women, and it's from Kangaroo, which is about a story from your is it high school or junior high?
Yeah, it was middle school, high school.
And you said, what the world told me and what it continues to, that women are not enough unless we are damn near see-through. Mm. That our worth lies in the gap between our thighs, or the structure of our face, or the number called our size.
Mm.
And I was like, circle, yes! and I think so many people feel that way.
I think for me, I've had to redefine, I don't want to be skinny, I want to be healthy. You know what I mean? I don't want to be, I want to be able to nourish myself and take care of myself. And that doesn't just mean my body, it means my mind, it means my soul, it means my creativity, all of that. Like, nourishing those things makes me feel healthy. And when I feel healthy, I'm a better wife and daughter and friend and an artist and writer and all the things that I actually care about.
Yeah.
Way more than how I look.
Well, I love hearing you say that, because I say that all the time to my kids and young women. I say, not skinny, healthy. I want to talk to you a little bit about being in your early 20s and making friends, because it's such a vulnerable place. And I remember being in my early 20s and not knowing who my friends were, at being out of college, starting my career, and not knowing who to depend on, and sometimes depending on the wrong people.
Yeah,
and
it's a letdown.
You talk about it in the book.
There's a couple poems about that. You know, I remember you actually really gave me some really good advice.
I did?
Yeah, you did.
Write this down.
No, when I was over at your house, we were talking about this. We were talking about, you know, being in this industry and women supporting women and finding friends and navigating that and telling ourselves and recalibrating our brains to go, there is room for everyone. Let's include everyone and do it intentionally. And I think, you know, I struggled early on going, there's no women on the radio. There's no room. How did I get here? There's no room for anyone else. Yeah. I'm competitive. I don't want to be competitive. That's not my spirit, but I'm feeling that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And really, there's a poem in there called Looking Sideways, and it's all about, you know, women coming up and me going, oh my God, does this mean that I can't be here anymore?
Like, right.
Which is insane. And you were so lovely and just explaining to me that, you know, the more the merrier. That's how change happens, is when you don't put your shoulders out, but your hands out, you know, and you kind of come up together. And you were really, it was really an important conversation for me when you helped me understand that. So I think that, you know, I have my personal friends that are like my small circle that I've known since I was in middle school, till the day I die, those will be like the people that I'm like, die, oh my God, yes. Guess what I just did. Or also they'll be like, this song sucks, Kelsey. You know what I mean? Like they're just so honest with me. But I also, you know, within the industry, now I have much better relationships than I did 5 years ago because I've been able to go, yeah, you're right. The more the merrier. Like female friendship, female camaraderie is so important, and that's how you move things forward. And if the way you move that forward is by welcoming them, not with elbows, but with hands. So that's a big part in the book, and a big part, I think, of just growing up and kind of getting better perspective on life.
You know, I felt that coming up as a young actress, I felt really competitive because there was scarcity. Mm. There were only ever maybe gonna be 15 of us that ever made it. And it was terrifying. And I think a lot of women feel that in many different industries. It's not just entertainment, but banking and advertising and medicine.
Yes.
You know, we have to help support each other and lift each other up. I do want to ask you, are any of these gonna be songs?
Oh my gosh. You know, it's interesting. I really had to not write music while I wrote this book. I couldn't cross it for some reason in my brain. But yes, now that I'm working on the next record, I've found that a couple of them have inspired a couple of the songs. And I'm still so early into it, I don't really know what it's gonna be. But yeah, I think I dug so deep and found parts of myself that I didn't really know were there while writing this. And so I have this whole new undiscovered tank that I'm like gonna just see what else comes out.
I'm so excited because I'll feel like that I was part of that process.
You got the second ever copy. I can't believe you're sitting here and talking to me about this.
I kept calling your manager. So cool. I was like, I need that book. I've read the digital copy, but I want the hard copy in my hand. Also, do you want to talk a little bit about the cover?
Yeah, so I'm super particular.
Called it while you talk about the
which
cover.
There's nothing wrong with.
No.
And so I said, you know, I want the cover to represent every woman. I want it to be everyone. And so I sent the team, the art team, some ideas, and they sent back some stuff, and I was like, Not quite, and I'm not a painter, but it's something that I picked up over COVID because it makes me put my phone down and it just is kind of nice and meditative.
I love that, yeah.
And I painted this and I was like, something like this. And they're like, cool, that's the cover. So it ended up being something that I painted in the backyard with a glass of rosé.
That's amazing.
Yeah, but it's every woman. She's faceless, she's colorful, you know, and she
and complex and
has
contains,
a chest full of feelings.
She is. Exactly. Glitter and all. I love that story because I always say to people who are starting out, no one cares more about your dreams than you.
Yeah.
Don't put your dreams in someone else's hand. The phone is not going to ring about someone calling you about your dreams.
Yes.
So you have to be proactive. You have to put yourself. Sometimes you have to paint your own covers.
Sometimes you have to paint your own covers.
And that could be the name of my country song.
Perfect. I'll help you write it.
Kelsey, I love you. Thank you for sharing your beautiful
thoughts,
your beautiful heart with the world. We are all so lucky to have you.
Thank you. Thank you for reading it. Coming over.
Yeah.
Come over again.
Oh, I'm coming over next time without cameras.
Okay, perfect.
And just margaritas and tacos.
Perfect.
Or pizza.
Okay, pizza. Pizza and tequila.
Okay, perfect.